talk to you about living with energy and talking about the energy that is all around in our natural and built environments and how it affects your health and the energy within you. So this comes from, if you look around, everything from your lighting, your devices, your electrical wiring, everything around you, laptops and computers. So the energy I'm talking about, I had to learn this information over a total of 7 years, looking at the negative and the positive side of it. And since then, I've been able to transform lives and help people take back their health with a two-part system that I developed. So a few years ago, when I went back to school, I completed my master's degree in building sciences, and that is like the technical side of architecture. So we look at creating very healthy, green, sustainable buildings. I was very fortunate to have one of the best professors around who pushed his students to think outside the box. And I hope and I think that's what I did. So today I'm here to hopefully share some ideas and help you, and hopefully you can think outside of the box and open up your mind to some new ideas. So here's in my thesis, I developed design strategies in that house over there to reduce electromagnetic pollution in buildings, and I applied these strategies in a real home renovation downtown Toronto. So this was actually better than green, basic green design, because it incorporated a lot of new innovative strategies. And it was later published in a scientific journal. And what I was doing, I was following what's called the precautionary principle. And what that is taking preventative action now to prevent harm in the future. So tonight, like I said, I'm going to present to you the big picture on electromagnetic energy. So it's a bit about physics, a bit neuroscience, a bit of biology. Now, I didn't randomly choose this subject, but I chose this subject in my research because, like many people I met over the years, it actually, electromagnetic pollution can be harmful. So I learned this through from my own experiences. So I won't be talking directly about this research, but more about the devices we use every single day. Specifically, don't worry, your mobile phones, which uses microwave energy. And I think this is more relevant for you and your future. But don't worry, I'm not going to tell you not to use your devices. I'm here to tell you more how to use it in a safer way. So today's world population is about 7.5 billion, so it's not a surprise that about 65% of the world has a cell phone. Now, a few years ago, the United Nations, I don't know if you remember, but they said that more people have access to a mobile phone than they do to adequate sanitation and toilets. But on the positive side, these phones have actually helped lift people out of poverty. They've helped bridge the gap between healthcare system and the rural villages of Africa. Sorry. So we've never been actually more globally connected. Your generation is very connected and very technical savvy. The world is more energized compared to my world growing up. So I have to talk a little bit about physics. And we are electrochemical people, and we live with electromagnetic energy around us. And what these are three-dimensional waves. They're invisible waves that are measured in kilometers down to nanometers. So from the left, the waves are very large, and they are less energized than the waves to the right, which are more energized. So thank you. So the universe has naturally occurring electromagnetic waves that link all planets and all living matter together. And it's from which we've all evolved from. So even your thoughts actually produce electromagnetic waves. So one neuroscientist said, if you can actually hear the sound of it, it would sound like an exquisite orchestra. So the very high energy waves, like ultraviolet radiation and X-rays, they're so energized. They're so energized that they can actually break the ionic bonds at the cellular level. And this can actually create carcinogens that are linked to cancer. Now today my focus is on the microwave energy that is used with these phones. This is what connects your phones and also what cooks your microwave ovens. So the difference between this and a microwave oven is that this can't cook your brain, but it can actually heat your body tissue and can also induce high electric currents in your body. But it isn't, but it will not break your ionic bonds at the cellular level. So because we spend about 90% of the time indoors, the quality of your environment has to be healthy because it affects how you feel and how you perform. So just as chemicals can affect and harm you, so can these electromagnetic fields that come from a variety of sources. So World Health Organization has actually identified a condition called electrohypersensitivity. And it's a real illness and it affects a lot of people knowingly and unknowingly. So from my research during university, I had to do a literature review of scientific studies. Now this is a snapshot of some of the illnesses related to the various forms of electromagnetic energy within buildings. Now my focus on my research was not on health, and it was not intended to prove that this causes harm, but it was intended more to see how we can improve the indoor environmental quality by making it better. So electromagnetic fields may not directly affect your health, but it can actually be a contributing factor. So this is relevant to you because your generation is exposed to more electromagnetic fields than we are. So in university, I met a professor, Dr. Havis. She's from Trent University. She's very well published and an expert in this field. I dove into her science and her research and her literature because at the time there wasn't much available. And what I learned is that one of the first known symptoms from this type of energy is actually anxiety. So today it seems, I'm not sure if you've noticed, but it seems like anxiety might be an epidemic among young children, teenagers, and even older generations. So in my research, when I was working on the house, I had to measure the electromagnetic fields in many homes in that neighborhood. And what I found is the homes with the highest level of electromagnetic fields, those people were more stressed and more anxious. And you can actually measure the electromagnetic fields and feel the energy of the space. But the homes with the less energy, those homes were very relaxed and very less stressed. So this was a very unexpected observation, but it takes me back to my literature review where they found where back in 1868 was the first time they noticed that this type of energy was linked to anxiety. So more recently, I read a book called Disconnect by Dr. Deborah Davis. She details the history of mobile phones and safety standards and writes about all the scientific studies that have been produced over the past few decades, showing biological effects from short-term studies but from scientists all over the world. And they're linked to biological effects like DNA damage, infertility, problems with memory, and weakening the blood-brain barrier. So think of your blood-brain barrier. It's a protection layer around your brain that prevents toxins from your blood from getting into your brain. So what they noticed in the 70s is if you apply this type of energy to your brain, it actually weakens this blood-brain barrier, allowing penetration of toxins into the brain. So think of the blood-brain barrier like the ozone layer of the planet. So the problem today is there's a disconnect between science and safety standards. And it's a big controversial issue. There's a lot of studies. One study says it's okay, they're safe, another study will say it's harmful. So just as what I did in my research project, I took a precautionary approach. What can you do today to prevent harm in the future while still using your devices? So I'm not going to dive too much into the safety standards. It's a major controversial issue. But basically, the trouble with proving that something is harmful is that chronic diseases take a very long time to be noted in the body. And scientists have to conduct studies for a very long period of time in order to determine if something is harmful. Health Canada today says that it actually is safe, but you won't know for another 10, 20 years until you see the actual long-term effects. So in the past, toxins have always been used in the buildings. This is just some of the few things that are not allowed in buildings anymore, and not including mold, but asbestos, lead, benzene, there's so many more. But at the time, they didn't know these were toxic. So just like when I grew up, cigarette smoking was allowed in buildings. It wasn't until the early 90s that it was banned from malls and offices and public spaces. It wasn't until it was known that it was linked to cancer that it was banned. So similarly, my parents grew up in a time when other things were toxic, or they were doing things that were not harm, that were harmful. For example, pregnant women had x-rays. And so it wasn't until later that they determined that children who were born of mothers who had an x-ray were at higher risk in developing childhood leukemia before the age of 5. So I don't think it's intentional that we're being microwaved, but the greatest challenge today is waiting for the scientific studies to prove harm. So this is going to take a long time, so I recommend taking precaution now. So I think if I didn't study architecture, I would have studied neuroscience, and over the years I had to learn a lot about how the brain and body works. Did you know that your brain is still developing before the age of 20? It's developing until the early 20s. And if you're a supercomputer, it has the capacity to continue to grow as you learn. So with this, looking at the picture in the diagram below, imagine now putting a microwave energy to that brain. So this is a very well-known scientific study that was published. Now imagine what it would do to the electrochemical processes that happens in your brain and how it affects your data storage. So to the left, that image is of a 5-year-old child, and the penetration, because the skull is thinner and there's more fluid in the brain, it goes deeper and much faster compared to the brain, the adult brain, which is much less. Now when we're under stress, the brain shrinks. These dendrites, which hold all your information, it shrinks, and then you can't access the information. So it's sort of like when you're writing an exam, and at the start of it, you might not be able to access information until you actually relax. Then the dendrites open up. So I'm showing you this just for something for you to think about. Again, I'm not here to tell you not to use your phones, but in the end, I'm going to tell you how to use them safer. So I'm going to ask you one question among the young students here. How many of you think you might want to have children in the future? So a few hands. Okay. So a lot of the studies I talked about, Dr. Deborah Davis, she has a book called Disconnect. And so it talks a lot about studies that are linking infertility with men putting their phones in their pocket because you're constantly radiating your reproductive organs. So this is also a problem with women and pregnant women. So the fact that this microwave energy, the trouble with that and your reproductive organs actually goes back to World War II, when they noted that sailors would be on their ships, they would stand in front of these radars and it would heat their body. Eventually, they noted that it would make them sterile. So it actually dates back to World War II. So my recommendation is for your generation to safeguard your brain and your body. We've only been using these phones and this type of technology for like a couple of decades. So you don't want to wait for science to tell us later on that something is going, that it's actually harmful. So although Health Canada says it's a safer technology, I encourage you to use your devices in a safer way. So more recently, there was a CBC report on Marketplace. I'm not sure if any of you have seen this. And it looked at how many people were aware that within your phones, under settings, there's a warning to keep your phone away from your head 5 to 15 millimeters. A lot of people are not aware of this. And it was reported that 81% of the people reported that they actually don't know about the warning not to keep this phone on your head or in your body. So if everybody wants to take their phone out, you can go under settings and try to locate, this actual warning. So again, I'm not here to tell you not to use your devices, I'm only here to tell you moving forward in the future, you might want to reconsider using these in a safer way, not putting them on your head and not putting them in your pocket. So I'm just telling you two recommendations there. But here are a list of recommendations I would ask you to follow. So first of all, keep it away from your head and your reproductive organs. Turn it off or put it on airplane mode during classes or bedtime. Don't sleep with your phones under your pillows or next to your head. Use a speakerphone and text messaging. If you can, use a wired or wireless Bluetooth, a low-powered Bluetooth. Use it only when there's a strong connection, because when you're in a room with only concrete block walls, it's going to be harder for a signal to get through, and you're going to have to, it's going to have to work even harder to get the signal through. Keep the antennas away from your body. So if you have to put it in your pocket, store this part towards your body and the antennas away from your body. That's a safer way to use it. So children under 13 really shouldn't be using it because their brain is still developing. And read the safe use instructions. And also balance your inner energy life force. There was a whole section on this, on holistic energy and health and how we use it in architecture and balancing your inner energies, which I didn't have time to talk about. But as we move forward into the future, I do believe cell phones will become safer. I do believe the safety standards will catch up with the science. And remember that your greatest asset is you. So take care of what you have. Take care of your mind and your body and your spirit. And moving forward, you should be successful. Thank you very much.